All right. It's my pleasure to welcome Alex Dimka from the University of Nice, who will talk to us today on the fundamental groups of complex algebraic varieties.
Thank you for the invitation. I am very happy and proud to be here. And so today we'll discuss fundamental groups of algebraic, complex algebraic varieties. And I suppose that you know what is a fundamental group. Is a topological invariant, perhaps one of the first to be introduced by Poincaré. And it's also one of the most difficult to compute. It's very easy to define, but quite difficult to compute, given a topological space. I will spend some time on defining algebraic varieties, and you will see why. So what are these algebraic varieties? So the simplest example is the affine complex space of dimension n. And another example is the complex projective space of dimension n. And now, if I am inside one of these spaces, I can define hypersurfaces. This means that I just take the zero set. Let's say I work in the projective space. I'll consider the projective space most of the time. F of x equals 0, where f is a homogeneous polynomial. In n plus 1 variables, and we need the homogeneous because otherwise the zero set is not correctly defined. And a larger class of algebraic varieties are the complete intersections. Which are you choose p homogeneous polynomials of various degrees, and you look for the common zero set. And you ask, moreover, that the dimension of this zero set is exactly what it should be if the polynomial are general enough, namely if the dimension is n minus p, that is, each equation adds a really new condition. And then there are arbitrary algebraic projective varieties, let's say, which are just zero set of a family of polynomials. And inside these algebraic varieties, we can look at different type of properties. We have, first of all, the smallest class, which is formed by the smooth varieties. And being smooth means that it behaves like a C-infinite manifold, right? That is, I can choose the local coordinates such that it behaves, let's say, for an analytic point of view, exactly as an affine space at the origin. Then we have a slightly larger class, which is formed by the normal varieties. I will not define them in detail. Let's say that normal means two conditions. One condition is that the codimension of the singular set is at least two. For instance, if I look at a curve, normal is the same as a smooth curve. There are no singularities. If I look at a surface, a normal surface has isolated singularities. And the other condition is that a kind of a Hartog's property, holomorphic or regular functions, on locally regular functions on x minus x, the singular locus extends to x. But this is roughly the definition. What is interesting is that this property, the fact that it's normal, implies a more topological property, which is the fact that X is unibranch. And so we get a larger class of varieties here. And I will give the definition. The definition can be given either if I look at the analytic germ of X at any point. So this is the analytic germ. So this should be irreducible for any point in X. Or topologically, this means that for any X which is a singular point, if I look at X, any such point admits a fundamental system of neighborhoods in the strong topology such that U minus X singular, this is connected. So this is fundamental system of neighborhoods of X and X. And as example to show that the converse implication is not true, you just take a cusp, which is given by such a equation in the plane, and then you multiply, for instance, with a line, and you get a surface which is unibranch, but is not normal because the singular set has not codimension two. Okay? So if we think at algebraic varieties, we really have here a larger class. However, if we are interested in topological properties, and this will be the case today, these two classes give rise to the same topological spaces, because, a remark, any any irreducible algebraic varieties has a normalization morphism, okay, which replaces X with a normal variety. And this normalization morphism, which I will call, let's say, nu. So nu is a bijection, and actually this is the same as asking that it is a homeomorphism. If and only if X is unibranch. Why this is so? Because the fiber of the normalization morphism are just essentially the irreducible branches of this analytic germ. And so you see that from a topological point of view, we have here just the same class of varieties. Okay, some other examples of non-unibranch varieties or singularities, if you like. So first of all, there are the normal crossings. So here, normal has nothing to do with a normal variety. It's just normal in the sense that usual crossing. And this means that I can choose the local coordinates in some ambient space, let's say, such that my germ is given by an equation u1, u2, uk equals 0. That is a product of coordinates. And another example is the so-called Whitney umbrellas. Umbrella, which is given by this equation. And I'm not very good at drawing it, but the idea is that the germ at zero, which is given by this equation, is irreducible, unibranch, but if I move just nearby in the singular locus, I have two branches, and because of that, the germ here, this variety is not unibranch because it has points which are not unibranched. Okay, so this was a rapid course, a crash course, on the algebraic varieties, right? And now let's see how all this fits with our main question, the fundamental groups of algebraic varieties. Any questions? Yes?
So if you have a homeomorphism, what's the effect on the singular points? Do they still have the same codimension? Or in other words, what would be the
No, because here, for instance, this is homeomorphic to C2, which is non-singular. So the properties of algebraic varieties are not preserved by homeomorphism.
Okay. I have a question again. Why is it that normal varieties are only a little bit bigger than smooth varieties?
You will see. This question will get an answer in my talk. This is one of the main outputs of my talk.
I'm glad I can help you out here.
Other questions? Great. Okay, so now we really start to discuss fundamental groups of algebraic varieties. And the first result says that if I have X in a projective space, and if I assume that X is a hypersurface, or complete intersection, then automatically the fundamental group is trivial. And so this, the simplest algebraic varieties are not interesting for our problem. So to get really interesting fundamental groups, we have to consider complicated varieties with a lot of equations with respect to the codimension. And this result can be proved in various ways. The nicest way to, this is of course, sorry, if you have that the dimension of X is at least 2, because if it is a curve, a smooth curve has an interesting fundamental group. So as soon as the dimension is at least 2, these hypersurfaces or complete intersections are simply connected. And what is the reason? The reason is that there is a so-called Milnor vibration. And Milnor has shown that the link of any singularity, not necessarily isolated, has good properties. In particular here, the fundamental group of the link is trivial, and so if I write the long exact sequence of this field vibration, then I get the fundamental group of X to be also trivial.
Well, that's a local result, right? You've got to
project this. No, this is it's not a local result. Okay. I take the cone over the projective object, and I take the link of the cone. You are perfectly right.
Can't you also use the Lefschetz hyperplane section theorem?
You can prove it in various ways, but I like to mention this this proof. Okay, so now. This is showing that we have to consider complicated varieties. And so now, if we have any projective variety, then this X has a homotopy type. Of a finite CW complex. Or if you prefer a finite simplicial complex, because algebraic varieties can be triangulated. And the consequence of that is that the fundamental group is always finitely presentable group. Okay? And one can ask, what about the converse? Is it true that any finitely presentable group can be realized as the fundamental group of a projective variety? And the answer is yes. And the history for the converse claim is much more interesting. Pierre Deligne noticed many years ago that you can do this very easily if you allow X to be non-irreducible. And so here the idea is very simple. You just realize any finitely presented group. You can realize it as a fundamental group of two simplicial complex. And in this simplicial complex, you replace edges by complex line and the faces by two-dimensional complex spaces but in a very large ambient dimension, and then you get the correct fundamental group. And much more recently, this question attracted much attention. So Carlos Simpson proved that we can do this even with an irreducible variety. And the best result is by Misha Kapovic. So Simpson's result is 2011, and Kapovic's result is 2013. And this result says that we can choose X to be an irreducible surface with only two types of singularities, normal crossings and Whitney's umbrella. And the proof is quite complicated. It involves Bohr quotients, so goes a little bit beyond outside the classical algebraic geometry. But the fact is that we can realize any finitely presentable group as the fundamental group of an irreducible surface having only these two types of singularities. And there is a question by Simpson, which is still open. Do we really need Whitney umbrellas? Is it possible to construct a surface having only normal crossing and realizing any finitely presentable?
Normalizations of these
I don't know. So by normalization, this becomes smooth, as is clear. But this is smooth too. Okay, then the normalization is smooth. Okay. Okay. So. Yeah. I agree with you. Okay, so now on the other hand, so you see that if we go to the whole class of algebraic varieties, we get practically any finitely presentable groups. And on the other hand, if we restrict to smooth varieties, we get a lot of properties on the fundamental groups of algebraic varieties. And this is a study with a long history. It started by a question asked by Jean-Pierre Serre in the 50s. What can be said about the fundamental groups of smooth projective varieties? In particular, he shows that any finite group can appear as such a fundamental group. And now I will give you an example of a joint result with Alex Sucho and Stefan Padima of how restrictive the groups of smooth projective varieties are within a certain class of groups. So I will introduce a class of right angle arching groups, and then I will state the result. So assume we have so I will define now the right angle arching groups, right angled. And to define this, you start with a graph. And this graph has a set of vertices. And a set of edges. And of course, we represent an edge by a pair of vertices. And now to any such graph, we can associate a group, G gamma, which is the group with generators U. So for any vertex, we add a generator and relations. UV equal to VU if the pair UV is an edge. And let's look at some examples. So assume that gamma is discrete. Graph. This means that the set of edges is empty. And if the cardinal of the vertex set is equal to n, or m, let's say, then this group has m generators and no relations. What kind of group we get? The free group. Okay, so I'll denote the free group in this way. Let's suppose that we are at the other extreme, a complete graph. This means that all the pairs UV are in at the edge. And then, of course, we get a group with m generators, but an abelian group because everything commutes. Okay, and now it's easy to show that if I have a disjoint union of two graphs, I get the free product in the category of groups. And if I have the join, I get the direct product in the category of groups. Okay, and now what is the result which I announced? The result is like that in the theorem, so which is due to S. Papadima, Alexander Suchu, and myself. And it's a little bit old, but it fits very well with the new results that I will present after this. And this says that such a group is projective, that is pi 1 of something smooth projective, if and only if this is a complete graph, and moreover, with an even number of edges. In other words, we can get here only groups of this type. And yeah, so this M should be even. So we get only very specific class of groups, and this really can occur because these are the fundamental groups. If we have an elliptic curve, a curve of genus 1, let's say, and we take the product M over 2, this is exactly the fundamental group of such an algebraic variety. And moreover, this is quasi-projective, which means that it is pi 1 of something smooth quasi-projective. Quasi-projective means just the difference of two projective varieties. This is the meaning of quasi-projective here. If and only if this is a complete multipartite graph, and this means essentially is a finite join of discrete graphs, and according to what I explain, this means that the group is just a direct product of free groups of this type, and that such a space can really occur because you take the fundamental group and you take C minus N1 points, and then you multiply this with C minus N2 points, and so on, and you get such a group as a fundamental group of smooth quasi-projective varieties, right? And in particular, a consequence of our result is that groups like Z square free product with Z is not quasi-projective. So there is no smooth quasi-projective variety having this as a fundamental group. Okay? And actually there are infinitely many such groups because this class of right angle Artin groups is quite large, and the groups which appear as fundamental groups of smooth varieties are very restrictive, right? Okay. And so, the corollary of new results which I will describe now, will be that if I look at, I get the same answer for the fundamental group of normal varieties. And in this sense, the class of normal varieties is not much bigger than the class of smooth varieties. Okay, so this new result is a joint work in progress. It's joint work in progress, so with Dono Arapura and Richard Hain. And we are actively seeking an example of fundamental group which is a fundamental group of a normal variety, but not of a smooth variety. And for the moment, we ask her around us, and nobody knows such an example. So we expect that there are. We have found some properties which are different from of such fundamental groups and group of smooth varieties, but we are not really able to show that these two classes are distinct.
Let me make sure I understand then what the same answer means. So same answer means if pi 1 is of the special form that it's in gamma, then these results apply. So your question about the normal varieties versus the smooth projective varieties right now that you say no one can give you an example of would be of something that's not G gamma?
Yeah.
Okay.
So within that class, the fundamental groups coincide, but of course this is a very special class of groups. What about the other groups? And we don't have examples for the moment. But we believe they exist. Okay, now let's see what can we prove. For the moment. So there are a number of results. The first one is a little bit folklore, but I was not able to find a proof written down, and that's why I plan to include the proof in the paper. But if you guys know such a proof, I am ready to quote the paper. So let X be normal, irreducible, and let's say U equal to x minus x singular, then if I take the inclusion, induces epimorphism. Given fundamental groups. Okay, so in the smooth case, if I have a smooth irreducible variety, and if I take any Zariski open subset, the result is clear because I can use transversality arguments to make any loop here avoid the singular the complement of a Zariski open set, because the complement has real codimension 2. But here we are not in a manifold, so transversality results are not so clear. So that's why the proof is not complicated, but it uses some basic properties of algebraic varieties. Okay, but if you have seen a proof in print, I will be happy to take it. And as a corollary, assume that we have the following situation, x, and here we have resolution of singularity. Then, of course, we have here u, which injects here. We have here the projection, and this u also exists upstairs. Because one can compute the resolution of singularity, one can construct the resolution of singularities by blowing up subvarieties containing the singular locus. And if I write the corresponding diagram of fundamental groups, what I get is that the morphism induced by P star is also an epimorphism. And This is an epimorphism, and so if I dualize a little bit, I get a morphism between cohomology groups. Let's say with Q coefficients, if you write, if you like coefficients, and this will be a monomorphism. So this is the first corollary, and so the second corollary, if X is normal and projective, then two things happen. The first thing is that the mixed-host structure on H1 X is pure of weight 1. This is clear because this is an embedding, and so the mixed-host structure here is pure of weight 1 because this is smooth. It's just classical Hodge theory, and so this also has to be pure of weight 1. And the implication of this is that the fundamental group is one formal. Well, this is a technical notion I don't like to define right now, but you will see how this will appear in a statement that will be rather concrete in a moment. So this tells us essentially that this fundamental group is somehow determined by the cup product at the level of H1 and H2. So if we know the cup product, we can obtain a lot of information on the fundamental group for such spaces. So the result was known for smooth varieties, but it's new for normal. Yeah.
That behaves in a strange way?
H1 has no torsion because the torsion in cohomology is related to the torsion in homology, but is shifted by 1 degree. So here, if I take Z coefficient, it's okay. There are no torsion. If I remember correctly, my courses of algebraic topology. Okay, so now I will explain you a little bit how the result, the theorem here, which was obtained with Papadima and Alex Suchu, how can prove such a result, and actually the main ingredient is now extended to normal varieties. Okay, so let's say X is an irreducible variety, and we look at rank 1 local system. L on X, such a local system actually comes from a representation of the fundamental group into C star, which is the automorphism of C. And because this is a commutative group, such a morphism factorizes through the abelianization. And you see that we can parametrize a set of local systems of rank 1 just by H1 X C star. So this is a set of complex local systems of rank 1 on a topological space. And inside here, we have a variety, which I'll call it V1. V1 of X. This is a set of all such local systems such that the dimension of H1 XL is strictly positive, or as this group is not zero. Okay. And one can show that this is an algebraic set inside this space. This space, for instance, if I forget torsion, this is just C star power the first Betti number of X modulo torsion, or contribution by the torsion, if you like. And so this is naturally an algebraic variety. Inside this algebraic variety, actually an affine tori, inside this we have the algebraic set defined in this way. This has several connected components, and I will denote by V11x the union of irreducible components of V1x passing through 1, where 1 means a trivial local system. Okay. So now we have the following theorem, which extends the smooth case due to Arapura in, I don't know exactly, let's see, which is a year, a long time ago, 97. So now X is normal. And so if X normal and W is an irreducible component of this set, then there exists a morphism, a regular morphism from X to a curve. So here C is a smooth curve. And Euler characteristic of C is strictly negative. And the general fiber of F is connected. Moreover, this is surjective, such that this component can be realized just as a pullback of H1 of C, C star. So for C, I have a similar algebraic torus given by topology of C, the Betti number, or can be expressed, related to the Betti number. And so the pullback will transform a local system of rank one here into a local system of rank one here. And the theorem tells us that such local system satisfies this property, and any irreducible component comes by this construction. And moreover, let's see what we have here. We have, recall that this was a resolution of singularities. This is a C, this is a F, right? And so if I take the pullback of W, this is an irreducible component of the similar set of the smooth variety X tilde. So this result holds without the assumption of projectivity. So it's true for quasi-projective varieties. And the new point here is that it holds for normal varieties.
On the other hand, you don't control the translated components.
No. Not yet. Okay, so now once we have such a result, in order to prove results as the theorem mentioned involving Artin right angle groups, one has to do a little linear algebra. One has to define the resonance varieties. And the resonance varieties are defined in a very simple way. Adjust the cohomology classes such that there exists another class which is not proportional to alpha, so I work now with complex coefficients, such that alpha cup product with beta is equal to zero. Okay, and one of the main results, which was known in the case X smooth by Papadima, Suchu, and myself, is that if X now normal and pi 1 of X one formal, then what you get is that essentially this resonance varieties is nothing else but the tangent cone to this special set at one. And now, using linear algebra and simple properties about the cohomology algebra of such curves, one can prove the result. Okay. So, yeah, okay, so maybe this is a good point to explain where I use normality. So let's try to see how the proof of this result is obtained. So you have this diagram, x normal, and you have this resolution. And what you do is you take this irreducible component W here, take the pullback. Let's call this one. And show that and this will be contained in some irreducible component of the corresponding characteristic varieties. These are called characteristic varieties. And so if I apply Arapura's result for W prime, because now we are in the smooth situation, I get some mapping f prime to some curve, maybe c prime, such that the pullback of the okay. And so now the whole story is to be able to show that in fact f descends to a function here. And it's not so complicated to show that the singular locus here has codimension 2 because of the normality. And on the smooth part, this is an isomorphism, so automatically I get such a function on the complement of the singular locus. But now if you remember the definition of a normal variety, it has this type of Hartog's extension property. So if I have something regular on the complement of the singular locus, it extends everywhere. And so in this way I get the extension. One has to be careful because one has to show that the function is bounded, because this is not a regular function, this is just a function to a curve, which can be non-bounded, so one has to be careful in some sense, but this is how the normality comes into play. Because we can construct f on x minus x singular in an easy way, let's say, by showing that this map is constant on the fibers of P, that is on the exceptional divisors. And then one can extend this. Okay, so I guess I will stop here and I'm happy to answer your questions.
Okay. Well, let's thank the speaker first. Are there questions? Comments?
So what can you say about the polynomial groups of these normal varieties?
Yeah, so what we know for the moment is that they share all the properties that we know for the fundamental groups of smooth varieties. We are in the process, maybe, of discovering new properties. Maybe. But everything which was known to hold, like maybe you know that John Morgan has an important paper in which he showed that Maltsev algebra of smooth variety should have generators in degree 1 and 2 and relations in degree 2, 3 and 4. And this is a result published, let's say, in 79. And actually, if you look at Delin's talk at an international congress many years in advance, or a couple of years in advance, he announced this result with the name of Morgan for normal varieties. But actually, it is written down in the paper only for smooth varieties. So it's again a kind of folklore theorem that is, it was true for normal varieties as well. And we are going to give a proof of this fact in the paper. Okay? And so this results, then all the obstructions related to characteristic and resonance varieties, which appears in our sequence of paper with Papadima and Alex Suchu, all of them are satisfied by normal varieties because of this theorem, because it was that was the key ingredient in proving those results.
I have one more question. I was intrigued by the result you had, where you said that you could represent, where you could find, using Whitney umbrella and crossings, you could get any fundamental group that you want, a finally presented one. Can you say what the fundamental group of the normalization is in that case, which will be a smooth manifold?
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know. But I will ask Kollar, because Kollar is very much involved in this project. Not in mine, but in the project with Kapovich. They have a joint paper in which they show that if you allow surfaces which are not irreducible, then you can get rid of Whitney umbrellas.
It would be interesting. I'd be curious anyway. An object whose fundamental group understood like a normal space or something. And you look at a stable map from that or something else, whether you could then say something about the image.
Yeah.
And understanding what was going on in the example you gave would be perhaps the first step in doing that.
Yeah. Oh, there are a lot of interesting questions in the subject. Thank you.
Tony, I know you had a question. Yeah, you talked about homotopy type, and now you're talking about pi 1, but you talk, some reason why you didn't, you slided pi 2.
Pi 2 can be much more tricky because it's no longer, you know, the higher fundamental groups are commutative. So in some sense, it's a big simplification. But on the other hand, they are no longer of finite type. They are of finite type as modules over the ring, a group ring associated with the fundamental group. And to study the structure of them as a module of this group ring is a very complicated question in general. So I'm not sure that people have answered such questions. Dick Hain has a theory of Mishkov structure on fundamental groups of algebraic varieties many years ago, maybe 25 years ago or 30. And his theory applies also to higher homotopy groups.
What about the uni branch varieties and right angled amping groups? Is there a connection known of the type?
Between right angle groups and?
Uni branch.
As I said in the beginning, the uni branch varieties give exactly the same spaces as normal varieties. So all the results I stated for normal varieties applied also for unibranch varieties. Because the invariants are topological.
Okay, so how about the higher rank case? So Arapura's theorem for higher rank local systems. Non-abelian general.
Yes. We cannot do everything in one step. It's a very interesting project.
When I asked a similar question to Varchenko at one of our hyperplane arrangement comments, he said, you know, the rank one case is the really interesting case, and besides, we don't even know how to do everything there. Why would we move to rank two? That was a long time ago. Third advances.
Yeah.
Are there other questions or comments for Alex Dimka or Alex Suchu or anybody else in the room? All right, well, let's thank Alex Dimka again.